Good morning, church. How are we today? Good? All right, I know you've probably heard it 100 times already this morning, but to all the fathers out there, happy Father's Day. And and Michael said, and fathers to be. All right, let's go ahead and stand as we start our service. We're going to be singing hymn number 23, God is so good. God is so good, God is so good, God is so good, He's so good to me, He cares for me, He cares for me, He cares for me, He's so good to me, I love Him so, I love Him so, I love Him so, He's so good to me. I praise His name, I praise His name, I praise His name, He's so good to me.
Pardon me. What a moment. What a moment. Well, good morning. Good morning, church. And hopefully that'll be the last of any calamities this morning. So glad to see everyone here this morning. I'm glad that you chose to come out, praise the Lord, and worship with us. There are so many things that we have today to be thankful for as we remember all the fathers. If you would, I'd like to ask all of the fathers in the church to please stand up. Please stand up. All fathers in the church, grandfathers, give me a hand. All right, you may be seated. Thank you. Thank you for doing that. It's important that we honor our fathers. My father passed on from this life in May 12th of 1999, so it's been a long time since I've seen my father. My grandfather, his dad, passed on shortly after him. But I can definitely remember the things that they taught and instilled in me, especially my grandfather. He was a hard-working man that loved his wife and was faithful to her all the way through. They went through some rough times now. There's no one that I've ever met that's had an easy life, but it still was a blessed life, and they endured together. That's what being faithful means. And I'm so thankful for the faithful fathers in here that have raised children, raised grandchildren, to help guide them to know the Lord Jesus Christ, as that is really our role and our responsibility as fathers. Let's go to God in prayer. Gracious, loving Heavenly Father, You indeed are Father over all. But we have the privilege to call You Father now only because You sent Your Son into this world to take upon Him all of our sins, to die in our place. And yet we have hope in Him in the resurrection. We're so thankful for that. Now we can call You Abba, Father, a loving and enduring term that we can use and express towards You, and we can pray towards You now, Lord. You made a way available for us to do just that. Pray that You'd bless all of these fathers that are here and those that are yet to be expecting fathers, as Brother Michael has said, that Your hand would be upon them, that You would guide them, that You would instill in them godly wisdom, that they would know how to raise their families in the nurture and admonition of the Lord. We don't know that on our own. We need to be instructed. And as men, we need to yield ourselves unto You in order that You would, in fact, teach us in that way, that we would be the examples and the leaders that You have called us to be in our home. I am so thankful for the leadership that we have here. I pray that You would continue to watch over our pastor, Brother Farron, as he faithfully has served this church, and Sister Ann also. And I also am thankful for the deacons that we have, the leadership that we have through them, and the ministry that they conduct both outwardly and the things they do behind the scenes, which none of us see, but You do, Lord, and they're continually ministering unto us and for You. I pray that You would be with John Biederman. I'm so thankful that he was able to minister unto us this last Wednesday night. I pray that You continue to bless him, Lord, and heal him and strengthen him. We have many, many prayer concerns that are on our list. You know the infirmities that are in the body and in our bodies individually. We pray that Your hand would be continually upon those that are recovering from the knee surgeries, that You would be with Brother Greg, that You would be indeed with Charlie Chuck Waters. I call him that because he's my brother in Christ. I pray that you would continue to bless him. And Lord, I pray that you would be over all of those that are still recovering from these injuries, that you would mend them and make them strong. Lord, we know that there comes a time when we leave these bodies. We're thankful that we're promised a new one. But yet, while we are here, you know that we suffer, and you are so benevolent and loving. I pray a special prayer request for Sister Helen and her brother. I pray that all of those that we have that are in the hospital, in the nursing homes, that your hand would be upon them also, that you would bless them and continue to heal them. But also, Lord, that by your grace and your mercy, you would send a messenger to them, a person, a brother or sister in Christ, that would come alongside them and pray with them and let them know that they are not only loved of you, they may know that in their heart, but we can get lonely, and you have said that we would be the hands and the feet of your ministry. I pray that you would send those hands and those feet and those ministers to these individuals that are in the hospital and to those that are at home and they can't come to church, that they would know that they are remembered and loved and cared for, not only by you, but by the church that you have called out for your name, the special people that you have called unto yourself. I pray that you would bless all the ministries that we have going on, Lord, for the sole cause of glorifying you, and that we would continue, that we continue to be a church here, that we would continue to be a light here, that you would continue to grow those ministries. I pray all of this in the name of our Lord and Savior. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
All right. A lot of times we come to church and it's like aerobics, right? Stand up, sit down, stand up, sit down. Now, I'm going to give you, if you promise to sing out, I'll let you sit when we sing He Leadeth Me and How Great Thou Art. Promise that? All right, then you can stay seated. Or Mike, you can stand.
Oh, Lord, my God.
New man, like the bionic knees. Yeah, we're stepping good now. What a thought. I was just thinking about what he said earlier when he's praying about John Biederman. We haven't seen him up in the pulpit. In a while, and it was just a blessing to hear him preach on Wednesday night. He preached a message about the whole armor of God, putting on the whole armor of God. And is anybody in here familiar with what they call the Marvel Universe? They got this crazy little one is this Doctor Strange. You familiar with Doctor Strange? Benedict Cumberbatch. I kind of like the guy, you know, it's a funny character. But in the movie Doctor Strange, he went through a breakup in his life. He crashed his car, he lost everything, and he just spent all his money trying to be the perfect doctor that he was. But then he got into this, you know, mystic stuff, whatever. But when he first tried it, he did this little thing, and he tried to make a shield, right? And it popped in just a little shield on his wrist. Just a little thing. And it's something that John said in the message made my brain jump to that for some really crazy reason. Like I said, I got brain damage up here, and sometimes it leaks. But it got me to thinking that when John preached that message, he said that, you know, you have a shield of faith. Right? And he was talking about the Roman armor and the shield that the Roman centurion would carry around with him. And the thought popped into my head. He said, how, you know, your shield of faith. And I'm like, okay, well, how much faith do you have? Is your shield of faith like Dr. Strange's shield? Or is your shield of faith like that Roman centurion shield? So I just got to thinking that, you know, sometimes that armor is that thing that when he said that message, it just kept hitting me over and over in the back of my head. When I was a soldier for 20 years, okay, every time I was out on the field, I looked at them soldiers on the other side. I could see their armor. I could see what they were using for equipment. So the thought just pricked my brain saying, the devil can see how big your shield is. Wow. He knows where to throw them fiery darts. He knows what you're wearing on your feet, and he knows how big the sword is you're carrying. And that's been with me since he preached that message on Wednesday. I just keep thinking that through my head, thinking, yeah. We need to grow them shields of faith, strengthen them swords. He mentioned something about Bible drills. We used to have these little things with the youth in here about, you know, finding Bible verses, see how fast you can find it. He mentioned a Bible verse, and said, sometimes, I know some of my kids, and I say, go to the Bible and find, and it takes them a while to find it. They don't even know where the books are these days. You know what I'm saying? How to find, what book am I looking for, and where is it? Is it in the Old Testament? Is it the New Testament? You know what I'm saying? So we need to sharpen them swords up and grow them shields, strengthen that armor. So I thank John for the message he preached on Wednesday. And I like to hear from Ben. You get a different perspective from Ben. And I like to hear from Scott, too. You get a little bit different flavor from Scott, too. So, you know, it's always good to have, you know, iron sharpening iron and hearing the Word of God. That's one thing we get here, and I appreciate that so much. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Our Heavenly Father, again, we want to thank you for this Father's Day, Lord. We can be here in your house, and we can praise you, and we can worship you. Thank you for the songs that have been sung this morning. And God, we just pray that your hand would move in the service to follow, Lord, that you would just have your will and way in each one of our lives, and help us, Lord, to take this message that's been prepared for us. Help us, Lord, to take it and use it in our lives, that we can grow and be stronger for you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Lord, thank you for your love. Thank you for your mercy. Thank you for your grace. Thank you for your opportunity to have us come and worship and praise your name. On this Father's Day, Lord, we give all our praise for our fathers. But to over and guide directly them, give them the wisdom to take care of their homes, Lord. We have a pastor now as he's still on his vacation. He's back home, but watch over and guide direct him. We have a messenger now as he brings the message to Christ. And I ask it, amen.
In my lap for a good night hug. He calls me Dad and I call him Bub. With his painted old pillow and a boy named Pooh, he snuggles up close, 'cause I wanna be like you. I tuck him in bed and I kiss him goodnight, slipping over the troys as I turn out the light, and whisper a prayer that someday he'll see. He's got Jesus in me, 'cause he sees Jesus in me. Lord, I wanna be just like you, 'cause he wants to be just like me. I wanna be a holy example for his innocent eyes to see. Help me be a living Bible, Lord, that my little boy can read. I want to be just like you, 'cause he wants to be like me. I've got to admit, I've got so far to go. Make so many mistakes, and I'm sure that you know. Sometimes it seems no matter how hard I try, with all the pressures in life, I just can't get it all right. But I'm trying so hard to learn from the best, being patient and kind, filled with your tenderness. But the words that he sees,
Jesus in mind, will be the Jesus in me. Lord, I want to be just like you, 'cause he wants to be just like me. I want to be a holy example for his innocent eyes to see. Help me be a living Bible, Lord, for my little boy to see. I want to be just like you, 'cause he wants to be like me. Right now, from where he stands, I might seem mighty tall, but it's only because I'm learning from the best Father of them all. Lord, I want to be just like you, 'cause he wants to be just like me. just like you, 'cause he wants to be like me. Lord, I want to be just like you, 'cause he wants to be like me.
Thank you, Brother Andy. I forgot one thing that needs to be mentioned. Someone told me that a certain deacon has a birthday today. A little bird told me that. Is Brother Alan Surratt your birthday? Oh, come on, clap it up for the deacon. All right. Everybody together, you know what we have to do. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Alan. Happy birthday to you. God bless you, brother, for everything you do. All right. If you have your Bibles with you, and I certainly hope that you do, I invite you to turn with me to the book of Titus in the New Testament. The book of Titus in the New Testament. And we're going to be taking the passage today from chapter 2, and it shall be verses 11 through 15. Titus 2, 11 through 15. All right. Give you a moment to turn there. It's been a blessing already this morning. I hope you feel the same way. You know, we're going to be talking a little bit about the wonderful gospel and the grace of God. Grace of God. So if everybody is there, I would like to ask as many as are able again to stand with me for the reading of God's word. Titus 2, 11 through 15. I'll be reading from the Old King James. For the grace of God that brings salvation hath appeared to all men, teaching us that, denying ungodliness and worldly lusts, we should live soberly, righteously, and godly in this present world, looking for that blessed hope and glorious appearing of the great God and our Savior, Jesus Christ, who gave himself for us, that he might redeem us from all iniquity, and purify unto himself a peculiar people, zealous of good works. These things speak and exhort and rebuke with all authority. Let no man despise thee. This is God's word. Please be seated. One of the pastoral epistles, this was written to Titus as he was ministering on the Isle of Crete. And it was primarily written to him so that he would know how to set the church in order, how everything would be done orderly, and how elders and bishops were to be ordained, and how everyone was to behave and act within the church and without in their life, in the workplace, what have you. The doctrinal basis of all of this, though, comes from verse 11, where it says, "For the grace of God that bringeth salvation hath appeared to all men." That's the very basis of it. And we know that the scripture teaches us that none other foundation can any man lay than that which is laid, which is Jesus Christ. That's the foundation of it all right there. But there is something that we build up from a foundation. The Lord does expect us to grow and to go on and to move forward and to exhibit the grace that he has bestowed upon us, that others may come to recognize this light, if you will, that has come into the whole world. As it is said, you know, in every single pagan culture, there is some semblance, though it be not right, there is some semblance of a promise of a coming Redeemer, of someone that was going to be coming from heaven, or where they believed heaven was, that was going to offer some form of salvation or deliverance. Every ancient culture has a version of that. All of us at one time were living in darkness until the true light of the gospel shined upon us and we recognized the one whom God has sent into the world for us. We recognized Jesus, and not only recognizing him as a fact, but as our Savior and as our Lord. The grace of God that hath appeared unto all men. And this matter of clarity that God desires to give to His church and to all that would come unto the Lord, this idea of clarity really is a reflection of who God is stated to be in the Scripture. Pulling one verse of Scripture here from 1 John 1 and 5, very familiar text, but listen to it today. This then is the message which we have heard of Him and declare unto you, that God is light, and in Him is no darkness at all. If I may expound upon this in my own homely language here, it's like there's no shady side with God. He's given you the full disclosure. He's not holding anything back. God is light, and it says there is no darkness in Him at all. This desire of clarity, clarity in the message, clarity in the church, God desires that. Clarity of what? About this grace of God not only appearing unto all men, but the effect that it should have within those that have received Jesus Christ. With the effect that it should have within His church, His called out body. Again, when we go to Paul himself, he spoke giving his testimony here as recorded in Acts of the commission that he received, the words of the Lord, the very purpose that he was called out to be an apostle. Acts 26 and 18. It's to open their eyes and to turn them from darkness to light, and from the power of Satan unto God, that they may receive forgiveness of sins and inheritance among them which are sanctified by faith that is in me. The me is referring to Christ there. Those were the words that Paul was echoing that he received from the Lord himself there. To open their eyes and turn them from darkness unto light. That's the very foundation upon which the church has to be founded on, rooted in. Without that, we don't have a church. Without that, we don't have clarity of purpose. And in this matter of the word appeared, it's an interesting word as we have it translated here in our text. This particular word comes out of the Greek. And I hope my pronunciation is correct. This is for your knowledge as well as mine. It is epiphaino. It is where we get the word epiphany from. And it means to shine upon or to bring light. And it is translated in another place in Scripture. Here we have it as appeared, but it's translated in the Gospel of Luke in verse 79 from the testimony of Zacharias when he was speaking of John, his son to come, John the one who would be the forerunner of Christ. And this is what is said here, to give light, that's that word again, that's that Greek word, how it's translated, to them that sit in darkness and in the shadow of death, to guide our feet into the way of peace. It doesn't only shine upon us, but it gives light, it gives direction. You know, there's an illustration that I love and I'd like to share with you, is that a man might be out fishing, and all of a sudden a big storm comes up upon him. And the only place that he can find shelter along the bank of the creek is he finds just a little cave that he can crawl up inside. Now, he's not concerned with what might be in that cave at that time. He just needs to get out of the storm. He needs a shelter until the storm passes by. And the cave goes back a ways and it's quite dark, and he goes all the way into it. And there's just darkness all around him and maybe just a little glimpse of light coming out. And he just sits and awaits out the storm. But you see, without that light, all of us could find shelter in very dark places in this world. And in fact, when we were lost, that's exactly what every one of us did. Maybe some today that are still doing. Seeking shelter in the things of this world. Seeking shelter, if you will, in the darkness and the dark things of this world. He, the one who went into the cave, wouldn't have known that there was a big old snake right next to him. There's no light to shine. He didn't know that there was a great big black widow spider just right above his head. There was no light to shine upon it. He didn't know of all of the mold and the mildew that was in there that he was breathing. He wasn't concerned with that at that time. You see, there were hazards in that cave that would only be revealed by the light. And there are hazards in this life and in this world, again, that are only revealed by the light of Jesus Christ. How would we know righteousness apart from the Lord? And the answer is simple. We won't. We can't. Never can. Cannot know that apart from the Lord, to shine upon them and to give them light. Now, the matter here of this appeared unto all men, in some degrees, I know there'd be some that would disagree with that. I'm still your brother. We're still in Christ. But I'm going to appeal not to mystery, but to the Word of God. I'm going to appeal to what the scripture says. Hear this scripture. I know everyone in here can quote John 3:16. I'm not quoting that now, but you should know the next verse. You should put this one to heart as well. Hear what Jesus had to say. For God sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. It's not Preacher Scott's words. That's the words of the Lord. That's the words of the Lord. And that is the desired aim, if you will, of the gospel. God's grace makes clear the aim of the gospel. What is the intended purpose? There are many men in here that were former soldiers. I was one as well. I remember going out to the range and having to qualify periodically. I liked those days. It was a relatively easy duty day. But you still had to go out there. You still had to, you know, perform out on the range. You still had to zero in. You still, you know, we were taught the basics of letting all of your breath come out and just don't pull the trigger, squeeze the trigger. Just let the shot happen and everything's lined up. Because if you didn't do that, if you didn't have good aim, it could be an embarrassing day on the range. It could be a very embarrassing day on the range. I remember a buddy of mine. he was a corporal, and we were in Germany, and he was having problems with his eyes. He legitimately was having problems with his eyes. Well, we went out to the range, and God bless his soul, he was 0 for 40. He didn't hit anything. He didn't hit a single target the whole day. And I mean, you know, we loved him, but I'm going to tell you what, he was my team leader, so I had to ride him a little bit. I had to ride him a little bit, you know. Corporal Ofer is what we called him, but he did 0 for 40. But he had a reason why he couldn't hit the target, but aim is important. Okay, we got to have a purpose. Christ has a purpose in his word. God loves humanity. That doesn't mean his love is going to save everyone. He's offered Christ. God has made that offer known through the preaching of his gospel. And it's been preached everywhere in the world. Some have received it, some have not. But it has gone out into the world. Using the words of Paul again, talking about this aim, if you will, in ministry. I'm pulling from 1 Timothy 4:10 to highlight this point of God's grace giving us the clear aim of the gospel. 1 Timothy 4:10 says, "For therefore we both labor and suffer reproach," that's speaking of ministry, "because we trust in the living God, who is the Savior of all men, especially those that believe." Especially those that believe. That doesn't mean it is a universal salvation, but I believe it's showing there is a universal opportunity. That there is a universal opportunity. Again, Paul narrowing it down to his personal testimony. His personal testimony here, 1 Timothy 1:15 and 16. Hear this now. "This is a faithful saying and worthy of all acceptation, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am chief. Howbeit for this cause I obtain mercy, that in me first Jesus Christ might show forth all longsuffering for a pattern to them which should hereafter believe on him to life everlasting." I'm so thankful that our Lord has given us a pattern in which we can see. How so? By his word. By the preaching of his word. By the preaching of his word. I don't dispute the fact that we all are called, but there are other ways that he calls. Paul got called directly by a blinding light from heaven. I was convinced and convicted by the reading and this preaching of the Holy Scripture. It pierced my sinful heart. And when we speak about the testimony that he's given here, you know, maybe some of us, we've held back on our own testimonies. Maybe some of us are ashamed in ways, partially, of what we were into and what the Lord brought us out of. You know, I can tell you this, sister. I can tell you this, brother. I'd be right there with you. I get saved at an early age. And oh boy, I was a sinner. And I enjoyed my sin. But I'm so thankful that there was an offer made to me. Not once. Many times, brother, there were people that approached me with the gospel, and I was rejecting it, hardening my heart, living out in sin. I thank my God that he took me to a place of being completely broken and at the verge of wanting to commit suicide, but yet there was something that was drawing me. And there were resources that were being sent to me by a godly grandmother. She was praying and urging me to consider Christ. Her words were to seek him. Seek truth, Scott. seek that truth. And what did our Lord say about that? What did our Lord say? He invites us to do what? Ask, seek, and knock. This isn't Brother Scott making up words for you. I'm not appealing to anything other than the words of Jesus Christ, the words of our Lord. Is he your Lord? Is he your Lord? Then heed his words and trust in him. Now there are many good believing brothers and sisters in Christ, good believing brothers and sisters in Christ that can find themselves on, if you will, either side of the bank or the river of salvation. There are good believing brothers and sisters in Christ that might find themselves on the Calvinist side of the bank. There are believing brothers and sisters in Christ that find themselves on the ones that lean more to the libertarian free will on how the gospel is given to them. And it isn't to say that there aren't convictions on either side of the bank, if you will. But there are also problems on both sides of the bank. And it seems to me that both crowds on both sides of the bank are missing out on the fact that the river of salvation is flowing right by their feet and that God has provided it for them. And only the Lord can reconcile these two things together. Only God can do that. Only God can raise the dead. Only God can raise the dead. And that's part of this glorious light that has come unto all men, appeared unto all men. My goodness, there has not been a single person in the history of the world that has affected the history of the world as Jesus Christ. That cannot be denied, and you really cannot stay neutral towards him, can you? It just doesn't work that way. I'm reminded, and I've used this illustration many times, but it's a good one, about the creek in the wintertime. We were just talking about creeks here when we prayed. I love fishing in the creek. Grew up around a lot of them, small rivers too. You know, in Minnesota, towards the beginning of the fall, before the hard freeze in the winter sets in, or towards the tail end of winter when the temperatures rise up to above freezing during the day, and then they're below freezing at night, and you have freezing and thawing. Picture this illustration, if you will. There's a little creek, and it's frozen hard in the morning, but yet that sun begins to come up over the top of the hill. And as that sun beats down upon that ice, begins to heat it, begins to thaw, and the frozen water that was stiff and unmoving begins to flow. But something else happens, and it happens to that bank. That bank, right on the side there, well, the water on it also thaws, but it begins to run off and it begins to evaporate. And that same sun begins to bake the clay as the clay takes in more of the heat. And it begins to dry the clay out. And it takes it from a soft state in the beginning of being thawed to a hard state, almost as hard as a rock. You know, that clay had turned into a rock if it's left out in the sun too long, if it's too hot, if no water has touched it. If no water has touched it at all, it's just evaporate and turn to stone. But it's the same sun, S-U-N, that affects it the same way. Now, the light that has come into the world that offers salvation unto all men. It has appeared to all men. The word has been preached. It has the same effect. You see, the gospel will melt the hearts of those that are seeking God. And they come to a place of understanding that they need the Savior. They need him. Not just a desire to have him as, you know, as an accompaniment, but they need him. But that same son, that same gospel message, if it's heard too often by folks that reject it time after time after time, they are just like that clay bank that's sitting out in the sun too long. And they start to get hardened and hardened over time. And it gets harder and harder to convince them of the Lord. It gets harder and harder to reveal them the truth of the Scripture. It gets harder and harder for them to be pierced and convicted. The Scripture talks about that, about having a calloused heart. You know, above all things, I don't want anybody in this room, myself included, to become calloused to that. I'm so thankful. A few messages a few weeks back, maybe a month back, I was back there, you know, ushering, so I didn't get to hear all the message, but I heard a pastor mention something about finding his tears. Maybe some of you remember in context what he meant. Finding his tears. Being able to weep and show some emotions. And I grew up as a kid. It was kind of on my own an awful lot and became hardened by the ways of the world. And, you know, it wasn't manly to cry by any means. You know, you just suck it up and go on with whatever. A lot of us were raised that way. A lot of us men, you still kind of hold to that. But some of the mightiest men in Scripture wept. David, the mighty warrior who took out Goliath, and others also, giants, there were times when he wept. That mighty warrior, I couldn't handle David in a moment. I couldn't fight a lion or a bear. But yet, he had his tears at times. It's time to be softened a little bit. Softened by the Word of God. Softened maybe by our own sinful state. Maybe at times that maybe our love affair with the Lord has grown cold. Isn't what it ought to be. Happens to so many. Especially now in the time we're living in. It is so easy to be distracted. I've said this a number of times, but it bears saying that that's what can happen to all of us, is that we can begin to get hardened to the wonderful message of the gospel of Christ. And as I've said, there's no other foundation than that. Without that, we have nothing. We have just what would amount to a religion of works, just like any other religion in the world. Without the gospel of grace, without his unmerited mercy, that he's looked down upon us, his unmerited love, how he stooped down to us and had mercy upon us. We have nothing. Nothing without that. But the word does come and the word does separate. Jesus also did say in John 9:39, his words, and Jesus said, "For judgment I am come into this world, that they which see not might see, and that they which see might be made blind." That's speaking again of those who had received God's word, received God's blessing, but over time they begin to harden themselves to it. Murmur and complain. Just didn't mean much to them anymore. And friend, I'd like to ask you this, everyone here. We have the admonition from the Lord that we should witness and invite others to the church, share our faith. But if the faith doesn't matter much to you, how are you going to convince someone else that it really ought to matter to them? How are you going to convince them of that? Well, someone will say, "Oh, brother, wait a minute now, it's the Holy Spirit." But you harden yourself, you can resist the Holy Spirit too, and then he's not working through you. That's the scripture. We have the warning, do not harden yourself to the Holy Spirit, to his moving. Just like that creek in winter, we want to be like the water. Maybe our relationship's been frozen. Maybe we haven't drawn close to him in a while. Let the light of the glorious gospel, the love that you had for God in the beginning, let that warm your heart. Let it flow in you. It's the aim of the gospel. And again, Romans 10:11-13. The scripture reads here, "For the scripture saith," not Brother Scott, "the scripture saith, whosoever believeth on him shall not be ashamed. For there is no difference between the Jew and the Greek. The same Lord over all is rich unto all that call upon him. For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved." You know, I don't want to infuriate any brothers that hold a strong doctrinal opinions. I can tell you this, going back to that river analogy, I can confess this to you. I have been on either side of the bank a number of times. There were times when I was just an absolute hard-line determinist. And it sure was a convenient theology, because I didn't have to care about anybody. And then there are other times when I had swung the other way, but I was in denial of the fact that it takes the Holy Spirit, just like it took the Holy Spirit to act upon me. Now, there were agents that were involved. There were prayers that were involved, Spirit-filled prayers of God-loving people. And there were messages that were involved in that, and there were witnesses that were involved in that, which were use of the Spirit. But I can tell you this and confess this honestly before you, I have been on either side of the bank. And I have found the best place to be is right in the river. I have found the best place to be is in the Lord. I have found that's really where it's going. That's where that river makes a lot of bends and turns, but it's going to make its way to the final destination. Amen. Amen. God's grace makes clear the aspiration of the gospel. Gee, brother, you're getting a little bit wordy here. You're getting a little bit way out of reach here with your alliteration. Maybe so, but aspiration is an interesting word. Inspiration is God breathed, right? In. But the aspire is the breathing out of it. It is the working out of your salvation. The working out of your salvation in the gospel. And these are the things that are built upon this verse, the first verse that I read to you. So I'm going to back up here, and I'm going to read Titus chapter 2, and I'm going to read the verses 2 through 10. I welcome you to read with me. The scripture reads, that the aged man be sober, grave, temperate, sound in faith, in charity, in patience. Aged women likewise, that they be in behavior as becometh holiness, not false accusers, not given to much wine, teachers of good things, that they may teach the young women to be sober, to love their husbands, to love their children, to be discreet, chaste, keepers at home, good, obedient to their own husbands, that the word of God be not blasphemed. Young men likewise exhort to be sober-minded, in all things showing thyself a pattern, there's that pattern again, of good works and doctrine, showing uncorruptness, gravity, sincerity, sound speech that cannot be condemned, that he that is of the contrary part may be ashamed, having no evil thing to say of you. Exhort servants to be obedient unto their own masters, and to please them well in all things, not answering again, not purloining, that is to say stealing, but showing all good fidelity, that they may adorn the doctrine of God, our Savior, in all things. To be faithful to his word, to be faithful to one another, to be faithful to those in the church, in our marriages, and to be faithful if you're still working in your place of employment. Don't forget that if you're still working, there are a lot of eyes on you every day. Whether you know it or not, I work for JCPS. If it's not a physical eye, there are cameras everywhere. There are cameras in the building, outside the building. There are cameras all over the place. It's amazing what gets recorded nowadays in the time that we live in, is it not? All these videos just keep popping up all over the place. Beware. Behave yourself. Somebody's watching. But the whole doctrinal thesis of all of this, the reason why, is because Christ has been revealed unto you. And if you've received him, it ought to be so much of a special gift. It ought to be transforming your life. You ought to trust him enough to inquire in his word just how you ought to be living out your life. Maybe there's some things in there you've been taking for granted. Time doesn't allow me to elaborate on those things. And I'm certainly not talking about a doctrine of works. But works matter to the saved church. So that our doctrine doesn't get blasphemed. So that we don't be made to look like fools or hypocrites. How many times have you heard somebody say, I don't like the church, it's full of hypocrites? Well, yeah, you got a point. It's not completely true, but yeah, to some degree it could be. Shame on us. Let's take responsibility for that. Let's take responsibility for that and ask to be filled with the Spirit to actually live out our faith. Don't be ashamed of your testimony. It doesn't matter how dark it was. If you were pulled from it, somebody's going to need to hear it, because they're going to need to know the miracle and the saving grace of God and how it operated in your life. Somebody needs to know. This aspiration, this outworking of it, coming from the very Word of God, that's what instructs us. We are told about the wonders of the Word of God many times in this particular psalm, but one in particular in Psalm 119 and 9, it says, wherewithal shall a young man cleanse his way? By taking heed thereto according to thy word. According to thy word. But take heed to that word. Act upon what you hear today or any other day of worship where you hear a message. I mean, how many messages have we heard and it's just like it just fell by the wayside. Just fell by the wayside. It's like having somebody cook you a wonderful meal and maybe you took two bites of it and chucked the rest in the garbage. There's not much respect for the gift. Not much respect for the gift at all. You know, there was a blessing in the meals that were in the Old Testament. They always were centered around a meal. Hey, everybody's got to eat. God provides for your flesh, but there was something more than that. There's a blessing behind that. There's a blessing in taking in the meal of the Word of God and then being able to aspire it, outwork it. Outwork it in your life. Outwork it in your life. Amen. We also are called to separate ourselves from some things here. Ungodliness and worldly lusts. Lust can mean an awful lot of things, a whole myriad of things. Desires that just take the place of God, if I could summarize. But we show ourselves to be unfaithful when we become worldly. We show ourselves to be unfaithful in a way that James wrote about in 4:4. He says, you adulterers and adulteresses. He was referring to them in particular, for they were showing partiality in the church services, having divisions there. Know ye not that friendship of the world is enmity with God? Whosoever, therefore, will be a friend of the world is the enemy of God. Draws the line right there. I don't care for the world system. I don't care for the world politics. I don't much care for the world's humor anymore. It's all raunchy and nasty. I don't care for the world's discourse anymore. Human beings can't talk to each other decent anymore without cussing every other word. I don't care for the violence that is in the world where it's making everybody else violent because they're paranoid that someone else is going to, be violent to them. But the only cure is Jesus Christ. And the only people that ought to know about it are the church. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Redeemed of the Lord say so. And let us be faithful unto that. Because that is God's desire. That is God's desire that he teaches and he grows us up. He makes that clear here. That we should live soberly. That is moderately in between. Don't be given to extremes, especially in anger. Righteously, don't be injurious to other people. Don't be gossips. Don't be slanderers. Be careful about how you talk about other folks. Words can hurt. I asked it. Words can really hurt. People can remember what you say for years and even decades. And to be godly really means to be devoted to God. You know, the pots and the pans that were in the tabernacle sanctuary, they were devoted, given over specifically for the service of the Lord. What would it be if the church were truly devoted in that way? Truly given over for the service of God in everything that we do. That's what the aim is, that's what the goal is, that's what the outworking, the aspiration of the gospel should make clear to us. Last point this morning, God's grace makes clear the anticipation of the gospel. Maybe some of you remember, this is the only illustration I can use, but how many of you remember Heinz ketchup and the old commercial? Maybe it was in the 70s or the early 80s. They would have had the catchphrase, anticipation, it's making me wait. Yeah, you know that. And you had to just slap that jar until it almost broke to get a drop of it out. But it was supposed to be that good. It's just loaded with a bunch of salt. Hey, you can make it all. You can make any ketchup taste good. Just load it with a bunch of salt. But somebody else did it for us. So, that's what we went for. That's what makes ketchup taste good, is all that salt. But the point is that what we should be anticipating, is just this. Whatever happens to the blessed hope in the Baptist church? Looking for that blessed hope in the glorious appearing of the great God and our Savior, Jesus Christ. Again, we could make theological debates on what side of the river you're on this one. I'm looking forward to seeing the Lord. I'm looking forward to seeing the Lord, and that is the blessed hope. That is the blessed hope. If that's not your blessed hope, what are you hoping on? If we can say faith is looking back towards the work of Jesus Christ in completing our salvation and be assured of that, then hope is the looking forward to what he's going to do and his coming and his wonderful kingdom and the new Jerusalem. Whether you hold to in the air, on the earth, in the air and coming to the earth, point is, I'm looking forward to Jesus. Don't get lost in the weeds. Don't get lost in the weeds and miss the point. That's supposed to be the blessed point of the coming Messiah, the King, the one who will establish righteousness, the one who will finally do away with sin and death, the one who will usher in a kingdom that will never end. True eternal life and joy with one another in fellowship and with God. We won't need the light of the sun or the stars anymore, the scripture says. Because as it is said here, the light has appeared, and when we finally see it, it will never disappear. The sun disappears for a time. We rotate away from it every day. Some folks, like the sunset. Some like the sunrise. Some like noonday. Some like midnight. But, the world just keeps on turning. You only get so much of the sunlight every day. Whether that's for your good or for your bad, you only get so much. But there'll come a day when the light won't diminish, and it won't disappear. It won't disappear. And have eyes to see it in all his glory. We don't have those eyes now. I trust one day to have them. I believe in that. And that is the point of it all, looking for that blessed hope, the glorious appearing of the great God and our Savior, Jesus Christ, who gave himself for us. Didn't have to, wasn't obligated, gave himself for us, that he might redeem us from all iniquity and purify unto himself a peculiar people, zealous of good works. Did I mention zealous of good works? Have you heard zealous of good works? Is anybody here zealous of good works? Does anybody here really care about the salvation and the condition of others in the church? Out of the church, in the world, completely lost. Remember your own testimony, remember your own state, and remember where you were at and what God pulled you out of. And maybe you'd have some compassion for those other folks. Maybe we wouldn't get caught up in partiality. I pray so. As far as the blessed hope goes, another scripture that confirms that, the last one that I will quote for you, as support to the text, Acts 1 and 11. This is the angels giving the testimony to those, the apostles that were staring up into heaven when they saw Jesus taken up. Probably didn't know what to do next. I don't know that I would have. It'd be a pretty miraculous thing to see, but it happened. Which also said, ye men of Galilee, why stand ye gazing up into the heavens? This same Jesus, which is taken up from you into heaven, shall come in like manner as you have seen him go into heaven. I'm not appealing to anything else. I'm not appealing to anybody's commentary. I'm appealing to the Word of God as it's translated to me. And that's what it says. And that's what I believe. And that ends the discussion for me. And I find great peace in that. I find great peace in resting in the fact that I believe what the Bible says. I don't mind if people ridicule me for my faith. I've seen the evidence of it in my life. I've seen answered prayers. I know that my sins in the past, though they were many, have been forgiven. And as he grows me in the grace and the knowledge of him, I see wonders that are happening every day. I thank my God for the silver on my head, which means that I've lived for a considerable amount of time on this earth, and that I've seen children and I've seen grandchildren, and I've met people within the church. And I've been, a recipient of men's ministries that they have poured out, and I've grown from them, and I thank my God for that. And I believe the word that they preached. And I believe in all of those who had given their lives so that we could have the scripture. They didn't have an easy road, not like you and I have. There were men that were executed for this in gruesome ways, just so the common man, the average man, the farmer out plowing the field could know as much scripture as the priest. And that really was the point of the Reformation anyway, that the common man could have the scripture, that everybody could know the Lord, that it could be shared. And I testify to you this day, that is God's will. That is God's will. Light is coming into this world, and he's offering it to all. And that is why it is a whosoever will gospel. The Holy Spirit affects us. Like I said, don't get hung up throwing stones on your side of the river. Just get on in the water. Get on in it. Get on in it and be baptized into new life through Jesus Christ. Trust in him. Trust in him. That's what we're called to do. That's the glorious gospel of God. And that's what it should produce in us. It should produce men and women of order, men and women of love, men and women of conviction and faith. That hold forth, that we occupy until he comes. Amen? And amen. Sister Mary, that's all I have.
The Savior is waiting to enter your heart. Why don't you let him come in? Everything in this world to keep us apart. What's your answer to me? Time after time, he has waited before.
Again, I'd like to thank everyone for coming, and I'd like to just ask if by chance there's anyone here that has something they'd like to leave in the service in the congregation before we draw near to dismissal. If all hearts and minds are at ease, thank you, Brother Andy, for stepping in. You've been a blessing, brother. Always, again, I feel I don't want to take too much more of your time, but I feel that, you know, it's important to recognize the people that have been working behind the scenes and doing things at the church that maybe you're not aware of. And I said, Brother Freddie, all the way in the back, I hope you can hear me, brother. But hey, remember Brother Freddie for all he does. You wouldn't believe all of the cleaning and all of the yard work that he's been helping with around here. And you know, here's the thing. If he can do it, why can't some others? Just saying. We can always use help. You know, I gotta pull out the cattle prod at some point. I gotta do it. I gotta pull out the rod and start tapping some sheep. Let's move. God bless all of those up in the balcony every Sunday for what they're doing for the church. There's a lot of things that happen in order for us to have church. They are by people that are dedicated to the Lord, and they want to see our church prosper. Remember them. Remember Brother Dave over there. He does an awful lot with the finance and handling the money. You say, oh, I don't want to get involved with the money. Most don't, but somebody has to. Somebody has to. Remember my wife over here. She's involved in that. Miss Teresa is also. I just want to, you know, hand out flowers and blessings to those that are working behind the scenes. Miss Donna, I don't know if she's in here. She does an awful lot. Sister Ann's been helping us clean. There's a lot of things that happen. Brother Rodney back there has done an awful lot also. And there's probably many that I forgot to mention. You know, Lord, forgive me. I hope that you will forgive me for missing out on your name. But just know this, you are loved and appreciated for what you do. And I pray that the Lord would stir up the hearts of others to be involved in that. It is a blessing. Really, it is. It is a blessing to help out the church in any way that you can. All right, if no one has anything else, and I ask Brother Steve, will you close us out in prayer?